Hospitalizations for skin and soft tissue infections, or SSTIs, are rising in frequency. According to a recent AHRQ study, hospital stays with the principal diagnosis of SSTI rose 75% from 1997 to 2010. There is no clear explanation for this phenomenon, although it is likely due in part to the rise in community-acquired methicillin-resistant Staph aureus, or MRSA, infections. According to the 2014 Infectious Diseases Society of America guidelines, the first step in diagnosing and managing skin and soft tissue infections is determining if the process is purulent or non-purulent. Purulent SSTIs include furuncles or boils, carbuncles, and cutaneous abscesses. Non-purulent skin and soft tissue infections include erysipelas, cellulitis, and necrotizing fasciitis. This clinical distinction is critical as the management of both groups of infections differs. Incision and drainage, or IND, is necessary for the resolution of purulent SSTIs. And according to the 2014 IDSA guidelines, antibiotics, as an adjunct to IND, are only recommended if patients have severely impaired immune systems or evidence of a systemic inflammatory response. Next, clinicians must determine if their patient has mild, moderate, or severe disease. Patients without signs to suggest a systemic inflammatory response qualify as having mild infection. The majority of skin and soft tissue infections in the U.S. are mild and can be treated in an outpatient clinic. Purulent SSTIs can be treated with IND alone, while patients with non-purulent SSTIs can be treated with empiric oral antibiotics effective against the common pathogens, namely group A streptococcus, plus or minus methicillin-sensitive Staph aureus. Patients with typical SSTIs, together with signs to suggest a systemic inflammatory response, have infections of moderate severity. The guidelines recommend that patients with purulent SSTIs of moderate severity be managed with IND plus empiric oral antibiotics with activity against MRSA, namely trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole, doxycycline, or clindamycin. Patients with non-purulent SSTIs of moderate severity should be treated with intravenous antibiotics directed against streptococcus and methicillin-sensitive Staph aureus. As discussed earlier, the patient in this case had non-purulent cellulitis of moderate severity when she was admitted and should have been started on antibiotics targeted against streptococcus and methicillin-sensitive Staph aureus alone. The IDSA guidelines include patients who fail initial management among those with severe infections. They suggest broadening antibiotic therapy in these patients to include anti-MRSA coverage, as well as coverage directed against gram-negative organisms in specific situations, like necrotizing fasciitis. So that begs the question, has this patient failed her initial antimicrobial management? The involved area of her leg has not changed significantly since admission, and she has received broad-spectrum antibiotics for almost 48 hours. Most patients treated with the right antibiotics begin to improve symptomatically by 24 to 48 hours after the initiation of therapy, but some do not see improvement for 72 hours. According to the FDA guidelines for SSTI studies, a clinical response is defined as the cessation of spread or reduction in size of the SSTI plus resolution of fever 48 to 72 hours after starting antibiotics. In this patient's case, she meets the general criteria for a positive clinical response. She is afebrile, her tachycardia has resolved, and the erythema, edema, and tenderness have not spread since the initiation of antibiotics. Thus, her antibiotics have not failed. They've worked. In the absence of specific epidemiologic risk factors, most SSTIs are caused by Streptococcus or Staphylococcus species. As previously discussed, her initial antibiotic regimen was inappropriate because it was overly broad, providing gram-negative and anti-MRSA activity when it wasn't needed and is actually contraindicated now in the era of rising Clostridium difficile infection rates and the emergence of multidrug-resistant organisms. For that reason, it is appropriate to de-escalate her therapy now to a regimen that would have been appropriate from the start, in this case, cefazolin. It is important to clarify what might already seem obvious to you. You do not have to wait until the 48-hour timeout to make this switch. You could have done it as soon as you began to care for the patient based upon her presentation and the likely microbiologic etiology. Given her clinical scenario, you could consider making an IV to PO switch during your 48-hour timeout. She has improved clinically, although you don't know if she's taking oral medications. In this case, the narrowest agent with anti-strep and anti-MSSA activity, as well as good oral bioavailability, is dicloxacillin. Other potential options with broader coverage but good oral bioavailability include cefalexin, doxycycline, and clindamycin. Again, these oral antibiotics can be used from the start in mild cases of non-purulent cellulitis. If your patient is not responding to or slowly recovering on antibiotics, it is important to consider non-infectious etiologies that can masquerade as cellulitis. Stasis dermatitis may be the most common. Stasis dermatitis describes the chronic skin changes associated with chronic venous insufficiency, including erythema and desquamation. It is typically bilateral, which is very uncommon in acute cellulitis, and stasis dermatitis is typically non-tender. Lipodermatosclerosis, in its acute form, is a common cause of pseudocellulitis. It is a severe fibrosing paniculitis of the subcutaneous tissue and is another consequence of chronic venous insufficiency. This process typically starts near the medial region of the ankle and progresses to involve the leg circumferentially. The leg then takes on the appearance of what's called the inverted champagne bottle. In its acute form, the affected region can be erythematous, tender, and edematous. Although these patients may be at increased risk for acute cellulitis due to their abnormal skin, the chronicity of their symptoms, which can last for months, and the absence of systemic symptoms can help you make the distinction from acute cellulitis. Contact dermatitis, both irritant and allergic, often present with erythematous patches limited, for the most part, to the area of initial exposure. The lesions can be warm and painful, but again, systemic signs of infection are absent. Other mimics include thrombophlebitis, drug reactions, radiation recall syndromes, and insect stings or bites. For a more in-depth discussion of non-infectious etiologies that are often confused with SSTIs, please see the two articles listed in the For Further Reading section of this case.